All right, what's going on, everybody? I am the one, the only, the W-O-O-K-I-E, joined here by some lovely men. We got Big Z.
Hey, hey.
We have Mr. Sheep. Doctor, yeah. I'm sorry, Dr. Sheep. You didn't
not
go
really
to all those.
Doctor.
You didn't go to all those years of medical school for no reason. Or you did. And JR.
Hello, KeyForge community.
So, obviously, if you've been living under a rock, I guess you wouldn't know about this. But if you haven't been, we did a thing. And this week, our thing is why we don't suck at KeyForge. Wait, that's not a part of it, is it? I'm looking at our notes now. This isn't a part of it, is it?
No, we have some ABR, so Ancient Bear Republic champions in the house, and we want to do a little switch up. Why we don't suck? Why don't you suck at KeyForge, Z?
Well, yeah. So ABR wrapped up while we were doing a thing, which we're going to talk about here shortly. But Ewok has joined me for my third season as team captain for ABR over there in the ABR League. And the Z-Force agents take down their third championship in that league in a row. And a significant portion of that is going to be attributed to the success of not only all of my team, but Ewok here on our show won his, what do we call it? So you get broken up into single elimination tournament buckets for the playoffs. Ewok took down the Sealed. With some masterful play that I got to watch in person. So that was a fun way to start off my last weekend. And then during the weekend on that Sunday, we finished up the net deck, whatever tournament brackets. It was me versus Rainbow, friend of the Discord. And he with net deck, you could choose any deck in the world. You show up. Since we were both going to be at the live event, we decided to do it in person. I was chatting with him back and forth, like, yeah, we can just make proxies. And I was like, sure, we can make a proxy of whatever deck we're playing. In the net deck competition for that week, I actually chose a deck that I own, and I was able to take it 2-0 and take down the net deck championship with a deck that I actually have the luck of owning.
I was just going to say, here's Z's weird flex.
Yeah, that was an ultimate flex, and I'm so sorry for the rest of the viewing nature out there, but ouch, that's all I'm going to say. And you know that deck very well.
Yes, it was a well-played match against the Chinese deck versus Galaxy, which is a locally owned competitive deck in this region. And yeah, it was a crazy season. I can't speak for Ewok, but I know as far as ABR goes, I think a lot of my recent success with ABR is like not trying to stress out too much and honestly just like play the games as cleanly as you can, go in knowing your outs, using a lot of the tips honestly that we've talked about over the weeks about why people may or may not suck at KeyForge and going in with a clear head and not trying to get too stressed out about the matches in advance and just playing clean and trusting in both the stuff you know to be the correct things to do and the decks that you are choosing to play for the reasons you chose them and seeing what happens. And that's done very well for me. Ewok, how about you? What's been your experience this season as far as not sucking at people?
The main piece is deck selection ahead of time, but honestly, just taking it easy. I found myself in the Sealed championship. And so with the 8 different individuals there, I think ABR did a really, really nice job at actually breaking it up so that there was no runaway team. It actually was very close with the final 8 teams that made it in. And so that was really neat to be able to see everyone there. Playing Sealed at the very end, I can't stress. There's no looking at the deck really ahead of time or doing much prep work. So it just comes down to in Sealed what you're really looking for. What are some outs? I know there was one of the decks that I was looking at. Honestly, it had some better stats, but I looked at my playstyle, and my playstyle did not match with it. And that was, I think, week number 2. And so,
yeah, week two, you and me had a discussion, and I think I would have went with the other one. But then when I watched your match, like you 100% called it, you were right.
Well, but again, that's knowing your own playstyle. So realize we've talked about SAS not being everything. Just look at what the tools are. And that's what I love about Sealed, is giving myself options. That is scaling Amber Control if it's there. Going ahead and having large Cs so that I can deal with creatures. If I don't have a large board removal, do I have lots of small removal? Do I have many big creatures that I can go ahead and remove those key targets? And I do place it in that order. I'd much rather have immediate response with board wipe and then targeted cards. But if nothing else, do I have a large amount of creatures? And then being able to min-max, kind of finding those houses where you can have a large run, you know, taking 6-7 creatures in a house, especially a large house like Sanctum or older sets like Brobnar, they can really pose problems when you put, you know, 6-7 creatures out of size. If you don't have an immediate response, you take over that game. So I've really enjoyed Sealed. That's kind of my forte, is to go in with not necessarily knowing decks, but being able to quickly evaluate and see, without knowing what's coming at me, start to look at the houses. What should I expect? What do I need to hold? There are key cards that you will want to actually hold in survival, in Sealed. And that has been something that has shifted with me the last couple of seasons of ABR. So not always just throwing out cards to min-max, but making sure that I have a response when necessary. Almost setting some opponents up, too. There have been a couple times where I actually took an off-house play, and it suckered. I wouldn't say suckered, but it brought out my opponent to be able to come back to that house, play more, and then I was able to wipe and really change that game. So I've been having a lot of fun, and I was lucky to be able to have the cards come out the way they did. And, you know, that's part of Keyforge. Draw better, get lucky.
All right. Well, should we move on to our thing that we did?
Yeah, we did the thing. What thing did we do? Wookie? What did we do?
I don't know.
You're the one I think was the least sure about all of us. So from your view, what was this thing that happened? What did we do?
I mean, we did Keyforge Live, right? That was a thing that happened this past weekend, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. I mean, I don't know if I was the least sure. I knew it was going to go one way or the other, and I think it went the other, which obviously everyone is totally cool with. Yes, let's see. We had 100 people in a total of 100 people in attendance. 71 played survival, 84 played sealed, and then we had 57 teams. So multiply 50.
We had 57 people play in team. We had 19
57 teams. People play in teams. Okay, I thought that meant we had 57 teams. I'm like, isn't that more than 100 people in attendance? I'm pretty sure it is.
There.
Yeah, 19 teams. Okay, so that is a thing that happened. We had a ton of fun. We're gonna get into, the true survival and sealed at a whole nother time, because I think there's a lot to talk about in each one of those. Like, this is the first time we've really seen mass mutation in the wild. Besides, like, you know, I guess not online, right? So I think there's a ton to talk about there. I think there's a ton to talk about in the true survival, and how true survival definitely, I think, played a little different from how we normally would see survival, and all that fun stuff. I don't think we're going to get too deep into teams, because there's, number one, we just don't have a ton of data on it, and Dan's our fact checker, so he says we don't have data. So I could make up numbers. Me and Z are real good at that.
Oh, yeah. We're pros.
Yeah, I know the winning team was using my reversal deck, so that's all I know from teams.
And as far as that, I think, number one, we got to give a really big shout-out to our three winners. And then you guys can, I guess, kind of go into what you thought. I mean, I thought it was a fantastic event. It was really great to see everyone come out. Obviously, if you haven't heard, we'll be talking about a little something called Shredder. We'll probably do a whole episode on Shredder and go through that, because that was a big deal and stupid fun. I think, Dan, you're the one who came up with this, or was this like a collaboration idea?
No, the core idea was my brainchild, and then as we were talking about it, we came up with some refinements, and it became Shredder.
But a ton of fun. We got to give a few shout outs to Sith of Angmar from Reapout. He won our survival event. Sealed was won by Jay Power from Kip, and the team event was won by Team Sass LP and Friend, which would be Corythan, X-Ray, and Drazcore. So big shout out to those guys. Congratulations on your winnings, guys. What did you think about Keyforge Live? Like, you guys were ready. You guys thought this was going to be a big deal. How did it overall turn out?
We really originally planned for 50 to 60 players, so hitting 70 and 80 was pretty amazing. All positive feedback that we've received for the most part, like nothing, no significant problems. The event ran really smooth. I mean, I think it went really well.
I think the biggest thing that hit me that like really made me the most happy was one of the days after the, I think it had to be Saturday after the survival finished. It was later in that day where the sealed was already happening. It was probably round 5, maybe round 6 of the sealed. So at that point of the day, you have some people that have already dropped from the sealed. You have pods firing, and you have your 4-round event, which was SAS cap that day. And I looked around. I'm running the SAS cap. I see pods firing. I don't think Shredder had started yet. Maybe that would have been the start. No, that started on Sunday. So we hadn't done the Shredder yet, but still, we had the pods firing with the four-rounder in its midst, and then we had the sealed finishing. Looking around, seeing all of those people continuing to play Keyforce, even if they weren't playing in a main, people were getting stuff on the prize wall, a few people were perusing the merch booth, like that. I mean, we talked about this as being kind of like our miniature Keyforge convention. It was at that moment I was like we did it. Like this is exactly what I missed the most as a player. This is pretty much the epitome of what like this game can be more of, more often, is the hope for the future. And it really made me happy that we were able to do this for everyone that was able to make it, and hoping that more people in our country and the world that can experience more of that, because like that, I mean, that's an amazing thing. Like that's what I've missed the most in this last 2 years of chaos that the world has experienced. And that was truly awesome.
I mean, and I'm not going to lie. Like, obviously, I've been non-apparent, really, besides for the podcast and even on the podcast with Keyforge. I realized how much I missed it, right? Because I had gone through, it was a pretty tough time for me. Those 2 years, we were running events, but, like, I get now more of the online doesn't work for me. Like, yeah. Totally understand it. Because it just didn't work for me. And until I was live in play, playing cards, putting cards down, doing the things, right? Like, I just was totally reinvigorated. I'm like, this is why I like this game. That's right. I remember now.
Yeah, and you're not alone, for sure. Like, my son doesn't play online. My wife doesn't play online. My sister doesn't play online. These people really do enjoy this game a lot. But they don't like it online. They don't play online. It's not like, it does not matter what the GUI for TCO looks like. It's just not the same. It is not the same thing. Yes, I play online, and yes, Dan and Ewok and occasionally Ryan do play online, but like, it is far from the same experience. Getting to forge the keys, shake the hands, meet the people, engage with them, even the actual like part of the gameplay, like looking through the deck list, having to do all of the things, making sure that you're playing clean in real life. Like, that's all part of that experience that had been gone for a long time. Like, a long, long time. And for one weekend, we did a thing. We gave that experience back to everyone that was able to show up, make it out, and have that experience with us.
I mean, I know not everyone got to play. I did And I should probably go into this, obviously. We did a little off topic here because, yes, the stream was in and out. I guess I didn't give a great explanation online to it. So day one, we had an internet problem. We were told we'd be on a dedicated line. That wasn't the case. And so we actually had, I don't remember his name. He told me to call him Canada. Anybody else?
I don't remember that.
Just me. Okay. But anyways, he was our internet tech dude. He fixed it. But then the problem happened, and you probably saw it around 4:35 o'clock. We lost all internet again. We had a quinceañera down the hall from us.
Ballroom was down the hall.
So you have 300-500, 14 to 16-year-old girls, plus adults, all on the internet, all at the same time. So that just ate our bandwidth. It was gone. And then, really once I did get to do the finals, at least the finals are up there. You can find them all on twitch.tv/IAM_TheWookie is where we put them all. I originally wanted to do it to YouTube since we don't have a dedicated AC Twitch, but it was just too resource intensive and we didn't have the resource, we didn't have the internet to run that. So, I mean, obviously lessons learned for next time. If we ever were to even think about doing this again, we know to talk maybe a little bit more about the internet. But
that's the most frustrating part. I know people don't hear our excuses, but we did talk to our venue a bit about that, but still in the end, it didn't work out. So
it is what it is. There's not much you can do. When it comes to tech, sometimes you just don't have it. I mean, I had the tech there to do it. We just didn't have the internet to push it. Yeah. It was what it was.
Yeah.
The main thing is that we had over 100 people there.
Yes.
That were there to play KeyForge. And I would love to have everybody that wanted to be there. I know some couldn't make it for, personal reasons. Some couldn't make it because their country won't let them leave. There was, 100 different reasons why people couldn't make it. But we did have 100 people there playing KeyForge, having a good time. It was even just nice to have the itty-bitty, table chat. Right? Yeah. Just that little stroke of, maybe it's not in-game, but you're just John. I mean, I can't tell you how, invigorating it was to be out in the wild and just playing.
Well, you're getting to see people we haven't seen in a long time, because, a lot of us have been to a few things, and we got used to seeing people ever so often. And I mean, I hadn't seen some of those people in basically 2 years, and that's a long time. I don't know. It's just this whole group that you knew and you met up with, you went out to eat with, you just poof, they're gone for 2 years, and there's nothing you can do about it.
And some people you're meeting for the first time.
Yeah, and that you got to know over the COVID.
Right.
Yeah, that was
another. So now you're putting a name, mm-hmm. I think the biggest and most difficult thing for me, at least, was matching their name to their Discord name.
Yes, yeah.
You know what I mean? Towards the end, oh, Draz, I don't even still know what Drazcore's real name is. But I knew the face, and I'm like, you're Drazcore. All right. X-ray. I know you, and that was putting that name to that voice, is just a big thing. Right.
But there was a really cool thing that helped you out with that. Right. It was called this name tag with a KeyForge card, and you could put your name and your Discord handle. Sorry.
You could put your Discord handle. Most people didn't. Just saying.
No, we had a lot of people who didn't necessarily see the background, but there was a debate about having the badges or not. And I think it turned out absolutely amazing. I want to give a huge shout out to the community as a whole. You showed up, you supported us, and we appreciate that so much. The lack of sleep across multiple days, I'm okay. We'll catch up on sleep. And it was a phenomenal, phenomenal, phenomenal event. From everything that we could do, a huge shout out to all of our judges, to our merch, to our our prize support to everyone on the team who came. You gave tireless hours, and we appreciate that. For all of the people who just showed up and just played, whether that was that you were out right away or whether you made it to the very end, you were laughing, you're giggling. That's what we need for this game. And we proved that we could go ahead and show a Vault Tour style caliber in that it was produced professionally. It was done with integrity. And I loved seeing people of all ages, of both genders, being able to be present and just having fun. So it was a highlight for the year, to be 100%
And
honest.
Shout out to Caffeine Buzz for yelling, "Bonesaw is ready." Style points to you.
I did hear that. I didn't see who said it, but I did hear.
I didn't see who, when he said it, I didn't see it. Who said it? But he had told me, he's like, "Did you like that?" I was like, "That was you." Dug it.
I did hear it, and that was great. That was,
I mean, that's it's those things, those moments, right? We even had, I mean, we had a damn fire drill, for crying out loud.
Yeah.
In the middle of Sealed.
Yeah.
It's those little unexpected things that now, you know, at the time it was like, what's going on? And, you know, now you can kind of, I guess, now look back at it and laugh at where it was fun.
But yeah, I went, can't like the fire drill, continued on without a hitch, and I was sitting there thinking, like, had we not got the crew that we got, put the things in place that we did well in advance, I think that could have been like pretty devastating. And it wasn't, like, in the end, like, again, people, and that's also because people want this, like, they want to have this, they want to be able to do this, and that's what we saw, people wanting to play Keyforge, and who knows, maybe it'll happen again.
Maybe.
But either way, let's break down what we're going to, so we're in the future, we're going to do a full episode of Survival, we'll do a full episode of Sealed, and then we're going to
More than likely talk, do a full episode on Shredder.
We will talk quite a bit about the Shredder. We are going
in. I can't. I'm sorry. I cannot. Like, Shredder is just, I don't know.
There's a chance next week might be the Shredder. I don't know if we're going to be able to contain
the format is so ridiculously over the top. And maybe it only, like, really attracts certain people. But, like, I was just like, this is the greatest KeyForge format. It just is. Like, there's nothing better than this.
All right, next week I will go ahead and make the rules PDF thing, and next week we could start with the Shredder.
And you know that there isn't a ton that's happening with OP right now, so that's where we create our own. We have always been about community, and so hopefully everyone sees that we back that up. That's you had a great time. If you haven't already gone ahead and responded to the Google form, there's a feedback form. We appreciate your information. Anything that you can help us. Again, if something comes up in the future, that would be things that we'd look at and just be able to see. But I think overall what we could control, it turned out really, really, really well. And things that we couldn't control, well, that's out of our control, and we'll see what we can do if something comes up in the future to make it even better.
Hey, absolutely. You guys are not working me as hard next time. I didn't get any opportunity to go out with Drazgor drinking, and I am pretty depressed.
None of us got an opportunity to go out with Drazgor drinking.
Yeah, but I told him I would, and then you guys wouldn't let me.
I mean,
to the grindstone again and again.
Well, I will tell you that first night I got 2 hours of sleep, so that was exciting.
Yeah.
There was not a ton of sleep to be had.
I feel like that sounds like two more hours than I got. I don't know. I was definitely nervous. After the first day, after Friday, I was able to sleep Friday night because I think of how well it went. Like, had it not gone that well, I don't think I would have probably went the whole weekend without getting any sleep.
I tried to just return to work on Monday, and I went, and I was mostly a zombie. And then Tuesday, like, again, Monday night, I just got stuck staying up late, got another, like, 5.5 or 6 hours night of sleep, and I went to go to work Tuesday, and I couldn't. I just couldn't do it, and I had to call in, and I slept for 14 hours straight, basically, trying to recover from live.
That sounds about right, because, yeah, I returned to work Monday as well, and I'm like, I'm not, if I ever do this again, I'm not doing this again.
Yeah, I'm taking Monday off.
I'm taking Monday off.
So what you're saying is you needed a vacation from your vacation?
This was no vacation, sir. This was work.
Yeah, I was going to say, like, it was there was no vacation to be had.
It was fantastic work, but it was work. Yeah, but I personally did not get home until Tuesday around noon, And I am still tired right now. It is Thursday, 5:30. I don't think I have caught up with the rest yet, but I will. I'll get there. Okay, so yeah, we're going to have those three episodes dedicated to those things, but today we're going to give you a little sneak peek with fun stats with Dan, and today I think he has something about top 10, because we're not giving up on our top 10.
Nope.
So fun stats with Dan, take us away. What we got?
Okay, so the one I'm looking at, we're going to talk about the top 10 cards that showed up in the survival decks. So I have, I made tags for Selection 1, Selection 2, and Selection 3 decks for all of Survival, and grouped them all in one giant tag as well. So we'll get that up on the Discord and places so people can look at them. But I have not posted the complete group here for anybody to see. So yes, we're looking at all decks that showed up at the Keyforge Survival. Now, if everybody knows, that should be 71 players at 3 decks apiece. So that's 213 decks. Although only 212 got played because Corey, Sith of Sigmar, he won on his second deck. He never even had to play his third deck.
For sure.
So that's you know, something, because we ran actual true survival, 13 rounds of true survival to get that done. But he never had to go to his second deck. So it could have been 14 rounds.
Did he never? He never had to,
he never had to go to his third deck.
I was going
to
say, I thought he was on his second deck. I didn't think anybody went undefeated. Yeah.
Yes, he was on his second, but he never even had to go to his third. So, okay, yep. Top 10 cards that showed up.
So are we guessing? Is that what we're doing? We're guessing.
Yeah, give me some quick guesses. Each of you give a guess.
Infernus.
Well, I threw out Infernus right away, so that was there. And I would also say Edai would be in the top 10. So Edai and Infernus, I would expect to see.
Back in the day, it'd be Dust Pixie. I feel like that should still be pretty high, so maybe Dust Pixie.
All right, where was Infernus on the list? Or was it even on the list?
You guys are right. Infernus is number one. But, like, how much more by number one was it than the next card?
Like, are we talking, like, a percentage or, like...
Yeah, sure. Give me a percentage.
I would say it was 50%
more.
50%. I'll go 30% more. 33% more.
That's I'm only going 20% more because it's got a number two. It can't be that far off.
You are all... Too low. So in the decks that showed up, which looking in at the decks of Keyforge analysis tool, there was a count for Infernus of 100.
That makes it
100 Infernuses
in 213 decks. That is 213 decks.
Number two card that showed up was Eddie, and that was in 56 decks, or an account of 56. It's almost double the number of Infernus.
More, yep.
Wow.
Like,
wow.
We were talking about Infernus is the meta before, and like this just shows it more. Infernus. Yeah,
we've been saying it was the meta for a while. This is like the 100% proof. At least some of the time, we know what we're talking about.
Yeah.
It's because there's so much recursion out there. Okay, so.
Well, that doesn't even count recursion.
Okay, so that's next. Okay, so that's number one and number two.
I guarantee you, none of you are going to guess number three.
I'm going to say Exhum. Is Exhum on the list?
Exhum is on the list.
Sweet.
What number three, as far as most common?
Okay.
No
so
guesses?
Exhum,
okay. It
well,
is.
Hold on. Exhum, okay. So mine was Exhum, but you said Exhum. It's not number three, but it is on the list, right?
I'm going to go old school with a little common card called Nerve Blast. I think there were some shadows because we did see a lot more than I anticipated.
Here to help you guys, maybe, is in the field, there were 133 logos, 128 discs, and 100 shadows.
Yeah, I was going to go with whatever common card the damage from Logos one is. Is it Twin Bolt? Is that the common one?
Well, there's Twin Bolt and then there's Positron Bolt.
Positron's uncommon, so Twin Bolt. I guess it's Twin Bolt.
You guys are all wrong. It is Daughter.
I was going to say it was either Daughter or Mother.
Oh, wow.
That actually surprises me to be able to see. But I mean, there's a huge benefit for the extra draw, but that surprised me a little bit.
And then... to prove that everybody sucks at Keyforge, number four is Wild Wormhole.
Wow.
So clearly people haven't learned their lesson. There were 53 Wild Wormholes in the field. But, you know, it's a common in Logos, and it has been in Coda, AOA, and Worlds Collide. So, yeah. Like, it has been around for a long time. Shows up in a lot of sets.
I am super shocked that I didn't hear more cussing. We should have kept a stat of how many Wild Wormholes lost you the game.
It's a hard numbers to get.
It is a hard stat to get, especially when you're not playing.
Okay, so here... Here's some other. So your next one was Exhum, 45 okay. Exhums. The okay. next one I think is also interesting. We're going back to Logos,
and this is number six, right? Yes.
That is a lot of Exhums, though. Was it Mother? Sets, right.
Well, Exhums and AOA, and Exhum, I believe, is in Worlds Collide.
It's primarily coming from Worlds Collide because there are only 11 AOA decks.
Yes, there's only 11 AOA decks and 11. Dark Tidings deck. There was 11 Dark Tidings decks. Okay, so interesting.
Only 11 Dark Tidings decks in Survival?
Yeah, that's not surprising, really. So, I still think it's interesting is in the whole field, there were 55 Coda decks, 64 Worlds Collide decks, and 72 Mass Mutation decks. So, Coda's on the way out.
And MM
and,
is
and
taking
the
over
Coda decks
world
are not like Coda decks we haven't seen before. Most yeah. of them, well, at least two of them won Vault Tours. At least two.
Yeah, I think the big news is MM is definitely here to stay. It is a highly competitive set and has a lot to offer players.
That's why I got two boxes chilling behind.
And we're
going to
go through the whole
crap.
Survival thing at some point after we do Shredder. But yeah, MM won the whole dang thing. So it's a thing.
And then, so we're on card number, what, six now?
Yeah.
So I said Mother.
Yeah. Nope. So nope. I think it's interesting, and it shows the rise of Mass Mutation, because it is Lethalogica.
Really?
And that is literally only in that set.
Yep.
Wow.
So 44 Lethalogicas. So only one less than Exhum. There's a ton of them. Okay, the next one, also an MM exclusive card.
Can we get a house? Is that possible?
Can we get a Savage Auto Clash? Give me a Savage Clash.
No, it is in your second most popular house. It is coming from Dis.
Jeez. Okay, so a discard from MM.
One of the common mutant creatures that destroy steal one.
Too many of them. No, I go Stirring Grave.
It is Mark of Dis.
Mark of Dis is good too. Yeah.
43 Mark of Dis. Going on from there, next Z was right on that. Twin Bolt Emission shows up.
Yep, it's in
41 of them, and then 41 Gateways.
Ooh!
Nice. Wow. Well, we did say there was going to be a big need for a board clear.
People listen. They brought their iconic gateway to this board clear.
All right. Also, and then actually tied in the 10th spot with 40 showing up is Dominator Bobble. And then our first non-Logos, non-discard. Note, everything else was Logos and Dis. This is the first one that was not Logos or Dis. What would be the most... So we're finally a non-Logos, non-discard. What do you think
it's gotta
is?
It's got to be a Shadows card, right?
No.
I'm going back to Death Pixie.
Nature's Call?
That's coming from the number four house, and it is Stealth Mode.
Okay. Yeah, that's a good card.
Good card in multiples, for sure, too.
Yeah.
And then it goes right back into Logos. Going after there, we have Infomorphs, Tau Taus, and then finally, the first, Coda only card, Urchin.
Yeah.
Is that because Dave's deck had five of them?
Dave might have fielded five of them in one deck or something.
I was gonna say he's swinging the curve there a little bit.
But I think this is a shout out then to FFG for our game designers. I know that you are listening in the background, but we see the importance of both Dis and Logos, and so I really, really hope in the next set that we don't lose both. I will simply say that Dis has had an impact on DT. And if both are going away. I hope whatever is brought back or added really brings some efficiency and brings a lot to that next set to make up for it, because you can see these are high competitive level houses.
Please just don't get rid of logos. Don't get rid of logos.
Get rid of logos. Don't go. Just make it go logo. Just
we got to fight. Driving back up to Wisconsin.
I mean, I don't know. Like, rumor mill has it Skyborn is going to replace logos.
This rumor mill is entirely you.
No, I heard this. Actually, I didn't get this rumor from myself.
He's like talking to himself.
I heard this rumor from other people at the event that Skyborn was on the rumor mill to replace logos.
Yeah, we won't go into rumors, but yes, there was talk about Mars or Brabner returning and Skyborn.
Wolfie mentioned it in the Discord. The same people from the Discord then came back over the weekend and were telling Wookiee it.
Now, if maybe they heard this rumor from me, but I'm going with it.
No, it was talked about with Asmodee Italia, but again, until it becomes official, I just think we stay away from the rumor mill and we keep talking about this amazing game. It's interesting to see what could be coming.
Oh, please get rid of logos.
No.
So here's some other things looking at these numbers. So you're saying maybe there's five urchins. There was not.
Oh, he didn't bring the five urchin deck. Did he bring the
outmoded?
The five Eddie deck was there.
Okay. For
sure. There was a five Hastasis Raptor deck.
Oh.
And then for other things, then that's the only five of decks. Everything after that is four of. And there isn't that many of those. There was a Ducilus deck, so two Ducilluses, which counts as four. There was a four Marsh First deck. I can see why that. Obviously, there's a four Routine Jobs deck.
I was going to just ask, how many Routine Job decks were out there?
I've never seen this deck, but there was a four Drumble deck in the field.
Okay.
Okay, interesting.
A four Gloriana Attendant deck. It's okay.
I mean, okay.
Four Hunting Witches.
That's
a lot of Hunting Witches. I know there is a five Hunting Witch deck in the wild. I've had to play it.
Yep. I saw it at Gen Con.
Yep. That's where I had to play it.
Yep.
There was a four Zap deck, a four Ronnie deck.
Ooh. Mm-hmm.
I'm pretty sure Texans was on a four Ronnie deck at some point.
Now, was this Ronnie deck from AOA or WC?
Don't know.
Okay.
Four Snorat deck and a four Infernus deck. So that was all the fours. There was actually an Angry Mob deck in the field. How about that?
Uh-huh. I mean, I did play that Angry Mob deck in Sealed.
And our
running a pods.
Our survival field stretched from 57 to 99 SAS.
Wow. What was pretty the 99 SAS good. Deck?
What was the 99 SAS deck, Z?
That might have been Akari.
Is it Akari?
Yeah.
So
that's all I needed to know. Thank you.
Yeah. So they looking at that, Ezra, as I like to trash on Coda. Coast, there was 23 Coda decks in the first slot, 18 Coda slots in the second slot, and only 14 Coda decks in the third slot. So nobody believes in Coda as being, or less people are believing Coda is their anchor anymore.
But it does. I mean, that makes sense in that Coda has the ability to high roll and just go off. It does. That's really, really interesting because.
Yeah, that's only 20% put the Coda deck as their anchor.
Okay. The other number that we kind of talk about on the show once and again that I think is actually really important to look at in reference to decks is we say, you know, like some people say Coda's king still, and look at all the great Coda decks. And, you know, there's 57 great Coda decks in this field. But what they often don't look at is how many Coda decks were opened, right? There is 1.18 million Coda decks opened. The next biggest set opened is AOA at 5 million, right?
No, 500,000. So
I did a little math. Yeah, sorry, 500,000. Thank you. Yes, not 5 million. So I put a little math in number of decks in the field versus number opened. So percentage of that, right? So if you take number of decks open divided by, or number of decks played divided by number of decks open, you get like a usage percentage, right? And topping that is MM. And mind you, it's 0.02% of all MM decks are actually almost 3.03%, but it's almost double what shows up in Worlds Collide. There's almost like for the number of decks opened, MM is significantly more likely, at least in this field, to show up with a deck.
Yeah, and I think we'd either said it directly or mentioned it a while back. Like, if the same number of MM decks were opened compared to Coda, all of the best decks in the world would be MM.
So here's the interesting. So it's 0.028 is what MM is at. Worlds Collided is at 0.017. What do you think the next set after that is?
Dark Tidings.
It is. It is Dark Tidings at 0.011.
Yeah.
So there are more Dark Tidings per opened in this field than there are Coda, which is significantly less. Coda is at 0.004, so less than half.
At some point, we're going to share data with you guys, and we can break this down in a more palatable method, because if we just give them the ratios and percentage, and then show the ratios of the event, that'll be an easier to compare thing.
Yeah.
Yes. Where are they going to eventually see this data, Wookie?
So all that data is going to go for free. I'm going to preface it with that, for free to the Patreon. We're going to be probably doing some stuff. So everything, all the articles, all the data, all the things that are written, at least from our point, our end, is going to go to the Patreon. They will be available there for free. And you can kind of peruse the data at your will. I will kind of put a bookmark on it, so you can see all the stuff from KeyForge Live all in one spot. So should be pretty easy. It's actually really interesting data. I guess the fact that Infernus and Edai were number one and number two isn't that surprising. I'm not really that surprised Infernus was number one. I mean, he was my first guess.
Yeah, I'm not surprised. I know a lot of people were asking for decks right away, and please forgive us. There's a lot that was happening in the background, and there still is. I mean, even with meetings, post-mortem meetings, what worked, what, just a recap, things of that sort, trying to actually get a little bit of sleep. So we do have the data, but it takes a little bit of time to make it so that it looks all fancy for you. And again, that will be coming up on the Patreon page, which will be free to everyone. So look for that in the future.
For sure.
It's my data. You can't have it.
I know, but a lot of people were asking for it. So again, forgive us that it didn't come out right away.
You want to Bogart some data? That's all right.
Limited sleep. We wanted to get it out as soon as possible, but we had to make sure we finished an event with everyone that was there first.
I mean, anything else really to say about the event? I mean, we're 45 minutes in. I am
just beyond glad and excited that everyone that was able to show up seemed to have a great time. I got to see friends, family, people I love in this game that got to have that experience thanks to us doing a thing. Like, we did a thing. I'm truly glad to have worked with all of you doing that, and for everyone that was able to support us in our endeavor.
Yeah, I'll follow up and say the team behind the scenes worked really, really, really well together. And so it made it easy, even though we were on limited sleep. We didn't always necessarily get the food that we needed to. We were there before anyone else and after everyone left. That's just part of what it is for organizing. It was fun. It was fun in the limited sleep frame just to keep going. And again, I didn't play a single game of KeyForge after Lokiar's Thursday event. I didn't play anything Friday or Saturday. I did join a Shredder pod Sunday just so I could finally kind of relax. And at that point, I felt comfortable. But the whole time, it was amazing talking to people who I'd seen, who I'd met online, but I'd never actually put a picture of their face with who they were. So huge shout outs. There were so many of you. I'm not going to run through individual names, but thank you, thank you, thank you for showing up. I also got a chance to meet significant others and other people. Things that were overcome to make it to KeyForge Live. Those are stories that will stick with you. So I'm just really elated to be able to share that experience with you. And hopefully in the future, I'll be playing on the other side and get a chance to play against you. But I'm really proud of the team and everything that was accomplished through this weekend.
All right. Dan, you got anything?
No, just keep playing KeyForge. KeyForge Live might be over for now, but we'll still have online events, and a lot of people's locals are opening, and this game is only going to go somewhere if we show up at our locals and we support the game in life, right? So I know it's comfortable to sit at home and play from online, but it's hard to build a community that way. So you got to get out and play some real games too.
And not to mention, I have two boxes of MM behind me that I need to open. Are we playing tonight, Dan?
No.
No. Okay. Never mind.
And I also cannot thank enough Luxury Playstyles. Thank you for your support. Thank you for all of our Patreons who went ahead. Sorry, the GoFundMe contributors. Guys, you made this so that it wasn't overly taxing. I don't mind putting some money in, and it made my wife feel a lot better when we finished. So thank you for that support. Thank you, Aegis, for the KeyForge adventures. They are absolutely stunning to see in person. And again, huge thank you to the community.
All right. Well, I think with that being said, we're going to kind of cut it as a shorter episode, huh? What do you guys think? Good? Yay? Nay?
I think it's good. We need to get some rest, start preparing our Shredder episode for next week. I've got a rules document to make and to post somewhere, probably on our Discord.
I am ready for Shredder. You guys are going to love it.
I saw some real Shredder pictures. People have already taken Shredder home and played it at their locals.
At least so two real stores in our country have already hosted a Shredder event.
Wait, what? How is that even possible? It just happened on Sunday.
Because they played and they took it home.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I can't say enough good stuff about it. So
yeah,
good
it's already job, happening. Wookie. Shredder is coming to a store near you.
I am ready.
If anything makes FFG hate us more, it's that we made a game where we just tear their stuff up.
No. They can't hate us. Please, FFG, know that we put on this event. We love the community, and we would love to have any of you come on to talk to us about what's coming in the future, because you have things.
I think they would love us for that. That means that more products.
Yes, people got to buy decks.
Yeah. They're buying more from them. They are happy for us.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So, anyways, that's going to do it for us this week. Do come in next week for Shredder if you are curious. I knew I was when I heard it, and I played it, and I loved it. So we'll talk about Shredder next week. Up weeks to come, we will get into the True Survival and the sealed event, first MM large-scale sealed event. We'll see what we had there, and many more to come. So we will see y'all